Look at that one. See what happens when you put it in the right spots? You can get a hog like that.
Back to our YouTube channel. You know, it's a time of opportunity right now. It is late September in Northern Ontario, and I think it's a timely topic for the people that are asking me. You know, you've seen over the years how many big largemouth have been fortunate to fish, and there's a lot of reasons why I fish late fall for big buckets. I love the brown bass, but I catch them all year long. You know, something about those big buckets in fall, the ones getting ready to hibernate, like a big black bear. They really are. They're big, lazy, fat. You know, they don't move around a lot. They just want to eat and get big and stay lazy. And those factors alone help me and will help you when it comes to fall, finding them with baits and presentations like the jig, beaver baits, and whatever little creature bait you have. This video is not about spooning deep water offshore ledges and stuff. It's not about crank baiting, spinner baiting, jerk baiting, none of that. This is about picking up the pitch stick like I do, pulling my hat down, put my glasses on, trolling motor down, and just go for it. Just go for it. I love to set hook all day long, just like you, but on this video and in this topic of fall largemouth in the North Country, all across the northern states and Ontario, it's about catching maybe 3-4 fish is a great day in late fall for big largemouth. We're not talking 2-pounders, 3-pounders, we're talking those big, fat, lazy things, green and black, that love to eat jigs and eat big because they know it's going to get cold and they're going to be hibernating somewhere. So now is the time between, I would say, early September to about, until the season closes, depending on where you are in the province. And for us, it's almost freeze up. If you can tolerate it, they can bite. You just gotta fish safe, fish smart. But I'm telling you, man, you want some of the biggest largemouth of your life, the whole season. This is it, coming up between now and ice up in the north. Okay, it's no secret what I like to fish with, the jig, okay? I believe you're a jig fisherman born into your DNA. That's not a criticism to anybody who else likes to fish the swimming baits, the spinning rods, etc. But Denny Brower said it right. Something about when I pick up this heavy power casting stick, I'm fishing for big fish. When it comes to largemouth, I believe that 150%. Seriously, it's the way I fish, pounding the bank, pound the shorelines, just doing it. You know why I do that? Because I love doing it. Now, if I find fish offshore hump, let's say, with some deep weed and the fish are ganged up on it, hey, I'm not stupid. I'll stick around there. I'll catch those fish, fishing totally vertically right below the boat, you know, jig, plastic and stuff like that. But for me, right now, to you hunters out there, I don't even have time to hunt because I fish so much. But this is virtually a way to catch the big largemouth by hunting. It really is. One-on-one, big stick, weapon, big jig, big plastic, big attitude, and big live wells full of largemouth. Early September, you know, we get emails all the time and questions from people at trade shows and what you do once September comes. You know what, and I'm fishing for largemouth and smallmouth, I'm doing almost exact same things, looking for big fish. But in this case, I'm gonna fish on shorelines a little bit steeper or heavier cover. I don't get out too early in the morning. It's about 9 o'clock now, and I don't find a big use unless I want to fish some top water. But you know what? For me, that's a real good summer pattern. And sure, it works in early fall, but this is the time where those big fish want to bear up. What I mean by that is they want to put on the bulk, eat big baits, eat heavy, eat often. So I'm going to show you today, hopefully, what I can do to put more fish in the boat to show you
on a lake that's got both largemouth and smallmouth with jigs, rodents, craws, stickworms, the whole deal. But I'm gonna show you some different locations possibly to find those fish, see if we can do it. I'm gonna tell you something real quick. It's called junk spots. They look like junk. Most guys go to the high potential stuff. They see other bass boats or fishing boats. Sometimes look for the junk spots, junky shorelines, because I guarantee you, bass can find the most obsolete nook and cranny little spots. If you can find those spots away from the public hot holes, or you know, the crowded spots, you'll catch fish that other guys don't catch by looking for those junk shorelines, junky looking spots. Use a bait like the jig, worm, rodent, craw, different things that you can put in right in those tight little spots where those bass rarely see a bait. Some more rock and weed right here. Let's see if somebody's home in the shallow stuff. Somebody big. When you put it in the right spots, you can get a hog like that. Whew, I'd say. You see what I mean? Whew, look at this, I'm losing everything. That's what I talk about. Look how he grabbed it. Early morning, September, largemouth. Look at the size of him. Oh man, did he grab it. I need my pliers. Nope, there he is. Let me just pull the boat out here a bit, just so I'm not smashing anything. That's what I'm talking about right there. That's a solid, big, fat fish. Maybe 4+. But you know what? Coming out in early September, when no one around, see what I mean about catching good fish? There's one right there. We're gonna put in the live well, take some pictures, and keep moving around all day long, fishing different stuff, and see if we can catch some big fish. Most folks are back to work and school. Okay, the jig, you know it, okay? Some with rattles, some without rattles. The 7.3s, okay, heavy power, a little chunk trailer. And basically, I've got a couple options, okay? And I stick with the color of money. What is that? Greens. I know a lot of guys like black and blue, and you have your favorites. Stick with what gives you confidence. Stick with what you like to use, okay? This is just a reference. This is about the time of the year of going to chase them and stuff. But I like dark greens, the ambers of wood, okay? Leadhead, trim weed guard, and different trims. Chunks I got, okay. This one I have like a smaller size chunk, so I trim the weed guard as well, so it just comes past a little bit where the hook is. This one, for a bit more action and thump, it's got bigger claws on the craw, because sometimes they want a little bigger movement, bigger profile. I know the jig's big enough profile, but sometimes they want that little thumping action of the jig, and that makes a big difference. Another option, you know it, beaver bait. And in this case, everyone knows different styles and options and stuff. We all have our favorites, right? What, 5-odd, big wide gap hook, tungsten sinker, same heavy line. And then last but not least, if the fish tell me that, you know what, today I'm not going to eat the jig. Today I'm not going to eat the beaver bait, but I still want to catch them. Well, then I'll go to another option, which is a little split tail grub, okay? Kicking little tail, but it's a little toned down. Profile. That's all it is. I'm still pitching. This is a 7.5 pitch and stick. I'm still doing what I want to do. Trolling motor and just go hunting, stalking them down in the nasty. And that could mean anything from tapering trees to shallow pads to heavy grass. It's all about stalking them down, picking the baits that you have confidence in and sticking with it. Just do it. Keep doing it. Don't worry. Don't think about after an hour or 2 hours that maybe, oh, it's just not on. The weather's not right. There's a front. All of that is an excuse. This time of year, there's fronts all the time. These northern fish are used to it. These aren't Florida bass. You know, they're not sissies. These are northern bass. They're used to the fronts, cold fronts, rain, dropping temperatures, you name it. They're built tough like you in the north. So you get out there.
pick up your favorite jig, favorite plastic, and I guarantee you, you'll catch them just like this.
All right, this is what I'm doing this morning. Fishing up in Northern Ontario on a small lake. And at this time of year in Northern Ontario, they bring the lakes right down. This lake, some of the people that I know up here say that's down 8 to 10 feet. So what does that do? Two things, man. Dropping water temperature, cold nights, the fish pull out and they school even tighter. Tighter than you've ever seen all year long, man, because they just want to get away from being stranded. Stranded means looking at the shoreline. Water is normally up on top of those rocks right there that you see behind me. So when the water comes down, the fish gang up a bit more. Water temperatures are dropping. They are on the feed bag. I don't know what I'm going to catch. Smallmouth, you know, largemouth. That's my goal, especially the smallmouth. They inhabit the exact same spots, roaming. And I'm going to swim the jig, hop it and pop it, skip it, whatever I need to do with a big hook, big bite, big rod. I got the St. Croix, big jig rod, 20-pound gamma edge fluorocarbon. Some of these lakes up here in Northern Ontario have that tea color stain, but I just get that confidence of, you know, fresh new fluorocarbon. They don't see nothing. All they see is that chartreuse jig hopping and popping, looking like something they can eat. So we're gonna go along different shorelines, trolling water down, just fish, pop it. Logs, rock, weed, anything I see, that bait is gonna stay wet. So let's go along, have a little fun, hope to inspire you to think about Northern Ontario in September for whatever wants to bite the jig.
Okay, when it comes to my rods, they're all rigged with this. What's this? 20-pound edge fluorocarbon. I don't go any less whatsoever, because the nasty stuff where I'm putting my baits is where I potentially can break lines. I don't want to break my line, break my heart. The deal is the fresh edge fluorocarbon, you can't break it. I change it all the time. Every week I'm meticulous about changing fresh line. I want those smooth pitches, no curliness whatsoever. You know, depending on your budgets and stuff, different sizes. Lucky enough, I have the bulk spools so I can keep changing, keep putting on jigs, beaver baits, baits with kicking tails and stuff. But the bottom line is keeping all the links in the chain fresh. Checking hook points, checking weed guards, knots, but the line is the critical link between you and those big fat largemouth.
It's important just to fish the fish in front of you. This time of year, I'm using up my sonar, watching this stuff. A lot of fish are on nothing. Like I said, you find trees and logs. Yeah, that's great. A lot of these fish are roaming, schooling. Packs, two, three, four of them, just on those edges of flats. So as the lake's drawn down, I look for the first lip. Could be 2 feet to five to six, seven to nine, but that's relative. It's just dissecting everything between me and that jig in the bottom. So keep the jig wet, you're gonna keep catching fish. Okay, what color is my favorite? Right there, green pumpkin with some chartreuse, with a matching, you know, green pumpkin, a little bit of chartreuse trailer, real simple stuff. And I got it with the St. Croix 7.3 big jig rod. Legend tournament bass, extra heavy power. A lot of times when you're fishing in the fall like this here, you go to lift up and there's already fish. With this rod, it helps, I say, increase that forgiveness. A lot of times you don't feel that fish, and sometimes you go to reach down or go down and get the hooks, pick up line and set hook. With this, you don't have to. You can just lean back, and that extra heavy power with that heavy gauge hook finds the meat. Very important. So chartreuse with green, exact same setup, 20-pound fluorocarbon, low-profile dowel reel. Everything's exact same, except the jig on this one has a little bit of green pumpkin with some silver and blue flake, matching dark blue with blue flake trailer. Real simple stuff. This one has a trailer, has a little bit of a rattles in there. You hear that? So sometimes when I'm shaking it up, if I find some deeper weed or rock and stuff, I'm really gonna work that bait. I'm not gonna be real subtle. I'm really gonna work it, because this is the time of year they want big baits and they wanna eat a lot.
Sloping trees. Probably the number one thing I'm looking for in late fall, all the way into mid-October, late October, early November. If the lakes you fish or rivers have fallen trees and they're tapering down with some depth, I guarantee you, if you don't want to fish them, please send me a message and tell me where those lakes are and rivers if you don't want to fish them, because they potentially will have the biggest largemouth of the year. Remember, the lakes come down, the fish pull out a bit. Those largemouth might not have their butts and tails right against the shoreline, but they won't go far. They'll hide in those trees, they'll sit there and be opportunistic, because bluegills and sunfish and things still come along, you know, they're not stupid. But those fallen trees, sometimes you can do them all day long, you know, all day long. Come back to a certain stretch and it's bang, 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 tapering. How deep? 5 feet to 20 plus feet. If it's real deep stuff and I'll be over it, I'll yo-yo it up and down until finally it just goes thunk, or there's just weight and I can hardly move it, those vertical hook sets. But the fallen trees, dudes, go along back and forth, make real milk runs, find the good ones. I know you're tempted because of summer to go fish the shallow ones and stuff like that. Don't waste your time. After a certain time when the temperature gets real, real cold, unless the conditions are just perfect and it's a perfect bite, maybe in late afternoon on a sunny day where they're just pull up a little bit to maybe get some more sun or some vitamin D in their body. But overall, odds are the highest percentages, those fallen trees in fall. You find them, I guarantee you, you'll catch them. Let's put it right in the lion's den, huh? Ready? Lion's den? There's a deep spot right here. You gotta be kidding me. You have to be kidding me. Yeah, look. That's what the jig does. Doesn't fall right there. Let me show you where that jig is, man. You talk about big fall bass. Look, see that jig? But look where it came out this side. Heavy gauge, heavy attitude. And you gotta know, it's jig time. In Northern Ontario, right here. What do you think of that, eh? Just gorgeous looking largemouth. Put him in there for a swim, then I'm gonna let you go, okay? I promise, because there could be a friend in there with him. Let's pull out. Go on, get in there. Let's pull out slow. Move out the way. But I mean, Northern Ontario, so many opportunities. There's so many species. Brand new lake, never fished. Look on a map, say okay, it's got largemouth, got smallmouth, it's got public access, I gotta go fish it. Okay, now you wanna know exactly where those big largemouth are. Depending on how cold the water is, and man, it gets real cold up here in Northern Ontario. But when it does that, and lakes drop down, you know, they do it all across the states and stuff like that with water fluctuations, and it happens a lot in Northern Ontario as well. Those fish pull off the real shallow shoreline stuff, but before they do, seriously, the Thanksgiving time has been, for me, some of the best last days of the shallow water bite. How shallow, you say? I say a foot of water. The same areas I catch them in areas that have open season early, like in mid-June, even before they spawn. I kid you not, man. Some of my biggest mistakes, seeing some of the biggest largemouth of my life, all I had to do was keep this little bait in the water. And I'm going from spot to spot, patch to patch, or wood or log, trees and trees. And I'm going to come across a shallow area, specifically on one lake, little red silver dollar pads, little red things. They were nothing. All I had to do was just pitch ahead. When I got to those little pads, that clogged up my trolling motor a bit, because I thought years ago it was too shallow this late in the year. I saw with my own eyes, witnessed three of the biggest largemouth I've ever seen in Ontario waters. Okay, seriously, seen with my own eyes. I can't tell you how fast I try to pitch. They saw me, they want no part of me. They scattered. But at first, I didn't even know what they were. Dark, big, beautiful fish until I seen that black lateral line and those big, round, black eyes that the giants have. I realized, Karl, you made a fatal error. All you had to do was just keep that bait in the water. If you weren't 150% sure that there wasn't a bass there, to this day, that was probably 15 years ago or so, I make sure that every time I'm in the boat, I don't care what I'm doing between fish or the spots that I think they should be on, my bait, regardless of whatever I'm throwing, jig, plastic, worm, it doesn't matter. It's in the water.
To yourself, boy, all summer I've got them deeper and edges and weed lines and crankbait and everything else. But this time of year, I'm back in stuff like that. Heavy pencil weeds, pads, grass, you name it. The stuff that you think, man, really? Are they in there? Fall? It's a time of plenty, boy. Big fish go back in the shallow water to feed. And you got to follow them. Pick your times when you're fishing it. First in the morning, it wouldn't go too shallow. I'd fish maybe 5-6 feet of water. As the sun gets up and gets warmer, get tighter, go closer, skinnier water. Those fish move. They know where they want to be. You know, you get a real cold night in the water, the shallow water, you know, it does get real cold. And sometimes it'll push them out a little bit, but not far, you know. But as soon as it warms up, that peak time, like I said, from about 10, 11 to about 3, 4 o'clock, the sun's high, those fish, you can catch them all day. But the afternoons are peak.
Oh my God. Oh.
Hold on, boy. Come here. Come here. Oh. Here we go. Look where you got it again, folks. Right up through there, huh? Look at that. Right up, way at the back. Because the water is higher. Why is that? Because it's been raining a lot. And look at that. On Xtreme Angler, boys and girls, the fall bite. Is it big? Is it fun? You see him jump out of the water? He thinks he's a smallmouth bass. You're going to join your buddy? And we're having a fun day, man. I'm telling you, boy, when it comes together sometimes, you know, the water is so high because a lot of rain. This particular lake's got a lot of creeks and stuff. So it brings in, a couple things happen. Water rises, the temperatures go down, but it doesn't matter. You know what, we're in a fall bite. Those fish, maybe offshore, all that kind of stuff like that, they're now tight again, they want to eat. That fish was so far back that as soon as I hit him, when he turned and stuff, I thought, what is this, a whale? But he's a good one. This shallow stuff is wicked because when the fish are there, if they're big, your heart feels like it's coming out of his chest when you hit them. They turn sideways, they bang, knock against stuff. They are the alpha male. Sometimes the big females too. Oh, oh, and it's a bronze back. Look at him go, I think it is, yeah. Yeah, it's a bronze one. Just knew right away when he starts to jump, flip-flop, flip-flop and fly. He don't know when to die. Fishing in the fall is one of the best times of year to catch smallmouth in Ontario and largemouth. You know why? Because you have virtually all the spots to yourself. You heard me say it before, but I mean those docks that are just in the middle of nowhere where you know guys usually run to them and all that kind of stuff. Most guys know where the good stuff is, but in the fall, September, October, early November, you got it to yourself. And don't kid yourself and think, again, oh, maybe it's too shallow that time of year. You know, the water gets cold. Yeah, it gets cold overnight. In the early in the mornings, that wouldn't be my first choice. But come around 11 o'clock to about 3 or 4 o'clock, that's my choice. You know why? Because they go in to feed. The bluegills are there. The perch are there. All the food's there, and then they're there. So in the fall, don't be scared to go shallow in the afternoons because that's where they are. That's where you should be.
Yep.
Nothing wrong with fish like that, huh? Look at him. Ready? He's coming in the boat, folks. Here he comes. That's what I like. When a plan comes together, boys. When a plan comes together, right there. Mr. Largemouth Bass. On the very last little dock. You think to yourself, oh, you know, I fished them all. I fished all the good stuff. And look what's there. Another chunky fat bass. I'm going to put them in there, take a couple pictures, let them go. But we're having a fantastic day. And you know what? It's over. I've caught enough fish. I've had a good time. It's about 3 p.m. And we caught them like this. Let me put them inside there real quick.
Okay. Everyone has their own way to fish for fall largemouth. Those are the ways I do it in the north. I've been successful over the years. I'm looking forward to this year as well. Hopefully you catch some of your biggest largemouth of the year this fall. But please practice catch and release, because these fish are very fragile and they are the fishery of the future. Some are still spawners. Let them go, let them live. And it's just like, you know, the big stalking hunter. You know, you found them, you figured it out, you hooked them, and then you got them in the boat. There's more than one factor. It's not about just pitching and getting them on. It's getting them in the boat and getting those pictures on social media. So I hope you subscribe to our channel. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and all that stuff. But I appreciate you watching our channel. If you have any comments, any questions, please post them below. And yours truly will answer them. Until I see you, hopefully I'll have more pictures on my Instagram and Facebook of those big, beautiful fall largemouth.
Ooh, there's grass down there. That's why. You're not gonna believe this, dude. You're not gonna believe that. You're not gonna believe that. Now, you saw it with your own eyes, right? Yeah, man. That is either a speck or a splake. I think it's a fall splake or speckle on a jig. Now, I know you've seen a lot of different things on different shows and stuff, but I would say that's pretty good, don't you? Look at it. Actually caught my dinner first thing.